Welcome to the Cisco NETACAD CCNA Introduction to Networks video series by Jason Johnson. This video is Chapter 3, Network Protocols and Communications. The material in this video covers the 6.0 version of Cisco NETACAD CCNA Introduction to Networks course. Thank you for watching these videos. Your time is appreciated. If you find the material helpful, you can subscribe to my channel. And remember to click the notification button if you want to see when I post new content. If you have any questions, you can leave a comment below, and if you watch to the end of the video, I will have links to the next chapter. Okay, so what are we going to cover in Chapter 3? In Chapter 3, we're going to talk about rules of communication. We're going to talk about in 3.2 network protocols and standards, and in 3.3, we're going to look at data transfer in the network and what does that mean. So, 3.1, rules of communication. So why do we have rules? What do we call rules? What are they? If you were going to drive on a highway, or if you were going to communicate, let's use another example of if we're going to communicate between two different languages, and I want to speak to someone in English or in French, and someone that's French wants to speak to me in English from French to English, we have to establish rules of how we're going to communicate. If I don't speak French and they don't speak English, then we're not going to be able to communicate. So we have to establish some kind of common rules to say, okay, when we speak, we're going to use French or we're going to use Spanish. Let's say that we both speak Spanish, but the French-speaking person does not speak English and I don't speak French, but we both speak Spanish. So we're going to establish rules that when we communicate with each other, we're going to use Spanish. That's an example of establishing rules in the networking world. So we establish rules, and there's a body. There's a group of people that get together, and they establish rules and to different networks, and they say, okay, we're going to put this network together, and we're going to set these protocols up. And they get together, and they say, here's the rules that are going to happen. So the rules that we establish in networking is that we identify the sender and receiver. So we need to know who the sender is, and we need to know who the receiver is. We need to have a common language and grammar. We need to have the speed and timing of the delivery established. And we need to do a confirmation or acknowledgement of requirements if that's required. Then we look at message encoding. How are we going to encode those messages so that they can be sent through the system? So the process of converting information into another acceptable form is the message encoding. So when it goes from, let's say, from your computer to the wire or to a wireless medium, we need to know how that message is going to be encoded or translated. The message formatting and encapsulation, the message size, the message timing, the message delivery options. Is it going to be unicast, multicast, or broadcast? And we'll learn about those in future chapters. We'll talk about what unicast, multicast, and broadcast is. So don't worry about those terms right now, because you will learn those in this class. So we have established our rules. And next, let's go ahead and take a look at 3.2 network protocols and standards. So we've established our rules. Now we're going to look at protocols and standards. Now, why do we, just like rules, we need to have protocols and standards because we need to know how things work together, that we're going to have a common, that things are going to be common so that they'll communicate with each other. So the rules that govern communications are called protocols. So the network protocols, let me back up. So when we establish a protocol, let's say that we're going to have a meeting, an official meeting between two people. And beforehand, we want to establish protocols, and we're going to say, okay, when the people meet, they're going to shake hands, and they're going to do a photo op. So we're going to have two politicians meet. And so we establish protocols beforehand, and we say, when those politicians meet, they're going to shake hands, then they're going to take pictures, then they're going to talk with each other for 15 minutes, and then we're going to do another photo op. That's protocols. We're establishing what's going to happen. And so the network protocols in the world of networking, the role of protocols, we establish protocols so that they have a role, and that is how the message is formatted and structured. It's the process by which networking devices share information about pathways with other networks, and it's how and when error system messages are passed between devices. The protocol also sets that. And the protocol also does the setup and termination of data transfer sessions. Now, the protocol interaction would be, for example, between a web server and a client. So we establish a protocol, and I have a computer, and I open up a browser, and that browser has certain protocols to say, okay, I want a web page pulled down to my computer. Well, there's certain protocols in place to say, I need it in a particular format. I need it in HTML format, and so it establishes those protocols to do that. And here's an example over here. So we have a client, it goes through the internet or the cloud, and it sends a packet of information, and it says, I need to get information from this web server. So the protocol stack says we're going to use HTTP for a hypertext transfer protocol. We're going to use TCP and then IIP, and then we're going to go across the Ethernet. So that's our protocol, or how that's established of how that's going to transfer back and forth. Now we have protocol suites. And protocol suites, there's been a number of them, and you're gonna read about those in the material in the course, and I'm only going to cover the ones on the PowerPoint slide here, or on the slide. The TCP/IP is an open standard. There are other protocol suites, and I encourage you to go into the material in the Cisco NETACAD course and look at some of those other protocol suites. The TCP/IP is one of the most common that we use today in networking, and this is 2017. TCP/IP protocol suites, and there's different protocols from the different TCP/IP protocol suite. This is a TCP/IP layer, or instead of the OSI model, this is the TCP/IP model here. You have your application layer, your transport layer, your internet layer, and your network access layer. In each layer, you have these different protocols that we set up. So for example, at the application layer, we set up DNS, or you set up FTP or HTTP. And then down here at this layer, you set up Ethernet to be able to go across your medium. And you want to look up the process for the TCP/IP communication process too. That's going to be in your reading. So that's something to look up, and you can go look that up in your reading in the course. The communication process. Now, standards organizations, I mentioned standards organizations a few minutes ago, and the standards organizations, they get together, and that was might be something like the ISO, and you can look up the ISO on the internet. The ISO is one organization. You might have the TIA, EIA organization, and that sets up open standards. That means there's some advantages to open standards, and you want to look up what are some of the advantages to open standards, and those are everyone knows what the standards are. They can be easily adopted by anybody. They're not controlled by any one person because they are open and they're put out on the market. So that's some advantages. You want to look up some other advantages, and if you go to the reading again in the chapter, you're going to find those. The internet standards are set in place. There's a few different internet standard organizations. ISO is one of them, and you can go and just search for that on the internet, standard organization, or look in your reading material. And then there's electronics and communication standards of organizations. And that might be the TIA, EIA that you have, and there's some other ones out there as well. So we have open standards, we have internet standards, and we have electronics and communication standards. But we have organizations that get together and they regulate, even though it's open standards, they still regulate what goes into those standards and those protocols and those suites. Now, reference models might be what we're talking about here with the OSI model and the TCP/IP model. Now, a benefit of having a reference model is that everyone knows how it's layered and how it's going to work, whether it's the OSI or the TCP/IP model. The OSI reference model provides a list of functions. There are seven, so you have seven layers to the OSI. It describes the interaction between the layers. And I will give you some advice here. You do need to memorize the OSI model. If you're going into networking and you're going into Cisco and you're going into the networking world, you do need to memorize the OSI model, and you need to memorize the TCP/IP model. And you need to memorize what protocols are inside each layer and what affects each layer. It's just memorize it. I use mnemonics. I always use please do not throw sausage pizza away. I always go from the physical layer up, but that's how I memorize it. And so whenever I go to do an exam where I don't have notes and I need to memorize the OSI model, I always write down PDNTSPA. Please do not throw sausage pizza away. And that's my cue of being able to memorize the OSI model. And over here you do NITA, NITA, and I just memorize NITA on the TCP/IP model. I don't have to do a naming convention for that. So I just do NITA. So that's network, internet, transport, and application. Now the OSI model and the TCP/IP model comparison, they are similar, but what's happened with the TCP/IP model, it's been simplified. So there are relationships between the two models. For example, you have the top three, 5, 6, and 7 of the OSI model have been collapsed into the application model on the TCP/IP side. And the transport is the same. The network is called internet on the TCP/IP, and the bottom two here, the network or the data link and the physical, have been collapsed into the network access. So the TCP/IP model is a little bit more, it's not simpler. It's just collapsed down into four layers instead of seven. So it's a little bit easier to memorize, and then things are, you know, it's just a little bit easier because it's smaller from a standpoint of memorizing it. Now, in section 3.3, we're going to look at data transfer in the network. Now, when we transfer data, we have to put it onto the medium and we have to send it along. Now, what we do though is we can't just send a whole bunch of ones and zeros. The receiving side needs to know when those packets are finished, or you know what request came from. It needs it. All those ones and zeros would just get be garbled, and they wouldn't know anything. It wouldn't be able to communicate. So, based on our protocols, we say we're going to have message segmentation, and segmentation means that we're going to break that communication into pieces. So we're going to take those ones and zeros and we're going to segment them out into little blocks. And a lot of times you'll see that represented by a little mail, like a little piece of mail in both the packet tracer and in the other material here with Cisco. And multiplexing is another term. It's called interleaving the pieces. It means that they can arrive at different times and then be put back together. You have protocol data units or PDUs, and you want to look up what are PDUs called at each layer. That's something that you want to look up in your reading material. And then the terms encapsulation and de-encapsulation. Encapsulation means that when we are going, and I'm going to move back up to the other model here. When we encapsulate data, what we're doing is we're taking information at this layer right here, and we're sending it down the OSI model. And at each layer, it's being encapsulated. So this information here is taken, and it's taken to the next layer, and it's saying, okay, I'm going to add some information to that. And then when it gets down here, I'm going to add the networking address. And when I get down here, I'm going to give it what medium it's going to go on. You know, where is it coming from? Where is it going to with the network? And then the data link information. And so by the time it gets down here, we have a full packet that gets put onto the medium, whether it's wireless or wired or however it's going to be sent. And then it gets sent along, and that is encapsulated. When it gets to the other end, that information comes in, and it, pen there got all wonky. So it comes from the other end here. Let me erase that. So it comes from the other end like that, and then it gets de-encapsulated as it goes back up so that it gets up to the application, whatever application you have up there. Let's say if it's a web browser or an email client, can open that up, and that information then is de-encapsulated so that it can be read by the application. So that's encapsulation and de-encapsulation process. Now, when we talk about data access, we have our network addresses, we have our source IP address, we have our destination IP address, and that can either be an IPv4 or IPv6. Delivers the IP packet from the original source to the final destination, either on the same network or the remote network. And the data link addresses, you have the source data link address and you have the destination data link address, and it delivers the data link frame from one network interface card or NIC to another NIC card on the same network. So that's the difference between network addresses and data link addresses. One sends it from one destination to the other on the same network or remote network, and the data link addresses are on the same network. So devices on the same network, and you would have the physical, it's just like, you know, you have your physical data link network transport upper layers. And so the timing and synchronization and bits is on there, destination and source for your physical addresses. And so, and when it says device on the same network versus remote network, that's, you're gonna need a network address if you're gonna go to a remote network, if it's not in the same network. Now, in chapter 3, we have looked at a few different things. We talked about why we have rules and how those rules facilitate communication. We've explained, or we've looked at the roles of protocols and why we have protocols and standards organizations. And then we've also looked at how devices on a LAN access resources in a small to medium-sized business network. And that brings Chapter 3 to a close. I hope this video was helpful for you. If you have any questions, you can leave comments below, and I hope you have a great day.